Hello and thanks once again for taking the time to download and listen to the world's longest running football fans podcast from CelticUnderground.net.
Laugh me a laugh, grin me a grin, and then I know that we can win. Dance me a dance, joke.
If you like what you hear today, you can subscribe at iTunes. And you can download or listen at a variety of places where I'm sure you can also subscribe. And these are SoundCloud, Audioboom, Spreaker and YouTube. And of course, the website, CelticUnderground.net. The contributors to the site and occasional contributors to the podcast can be found on Twitter. There is the long-running at Celtic Rumours Twitter feed. And then there is also myself at Harry Brady CU. There is at Hullboy, at Lackeymore1, and the catchiest of all, at Stephen62572390. And it is that man with the fantastic Twitter name who is doing this week's podcast with guest Mr. John Fallon. But before he does the usual introductions, there is an autographed biography of John's to win. This week, all you need to do is answer the simple question. It's at the end of the podcast. Yes, of course, you've got to listen to the whole podcast. So, question at the end of the podcast, email in the answer.
It's my pleasure today to be joined by John Fallon, the popular ex-Celtic goalkeeper of the 1960s and 1970s. Well, John, what was your first Celtic game and who was your first Celtic hero?
Willie Miller.
The goalkeeper?
The goalkeeper. 1946 or 47. Mm-hmm. I was 10 as a wee boy. And that was the first I can remember. Miller, Millen and Malin. I can remember Evans, Bowden and Bailey. Mm-hmm. And Macaulay. The forward line was just a chop and change.
Aye.
The two Gallaghers, I watched them and Corbett, all them. So that was my first time I'd ever seen them.
So what would have been your first Celtic game then? Can you remember getting taken as a boy?
I can just remember getting taken as a wee boy and seeing the Celtic. We always stood in the old enclosure.
Mm-hmm. The wee enclosure in front of the stand?
The stand. My brother always stood there. He'd buy that six and six, so he says, just for a wee bit of...
better view.
Better view.
Mm-hmm.
So we always stood there, don't we? Just a habit.
Mm-hmm.
And that was the thing. I remember the Coronation Cup. I went to every game there and went to the cup finals.
What age were you being then?
13.
13.
And I was sitting about here to that wall for the presentation.
Aye.
And it was the tickets. We were looking for the tickets. 7 and 6 months.
Mm-hmm.
And my brother and I went because the old street bookie... he's a hun. Oh, you're allowed to say that.
You're listening.
Yeah, that's all right. He's a fucking hun then. And he was showing the tickets off to my father. My father says, what are you want them for? They got beat.
Newcastle put them behind the
door. I think Newcastle. Uh-huh. So he's left with these two tickets. And he says, oh, here, get your boys.
Uh-huh.
So we got there, the twos went. I remember the three games. I was in the north stand for the semi-final against Man United.
Mm-hmm.
God's sake. You know, sitting away up.
Mm-hmm.
It was in the Celtic Park.
Mm-hmm.
The Man United game, Arsenal game. I've seen the Arsenal game, Man United. The only cup final I've ever seen Celtic win in was the 51...
Motherwell.
No.
Oh.
Aberdeen.
What is it, the charity?
It's the Mungo Cup. That was the only one I've ever seen them winning.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
I was in Aberdeen with the school. We came for about 10 days holiday.
Mm-hmm.
There were about 4 schools all went through to Aberdeen. And I was raging because we left that morning to get home, and I was hoping we'd get home in time.
Mm-hmm.
I made a jump in the special. Mm-hmm. This railway special, his trains. Mm-hmm. We never got there. That was one and only time I missed the cup final.
So how did the move to Celtic come about then?
In my early days, I was playing the boys guild. In school, Celtic started recruiting boys about. Kelly was bringing in the youth team.
Mm.
The Man United system.
Mm-hmm.
and I was about 16. I was invited in, and just, you trained one night a week, and then 58, you're 18, back in again. I'd been training with all the boys, Billy, mm-hmm. or Charlie Gallagher, John Divers, Mick Jack, we all mm-hmm. brought up that mm-hmm. that section. And then you just, if you were good enough, you went in. And I remember it was at December, the 8th of December. Aye, 8th of December, I played by a trial match at Motherwell, and it was ice. Mm. And you were scudding all over the place, and Charlie Tully was playing. So I can remember playing with Charlie Tully.
That's something to
know. And Big Billy was playing. Mm-hmm. We won, right enough. And I think Big Billy had scored an own goal. He just slipped his arse in the ball. Mm-hmm. And Tuesday, I was asked to come into the training. And old Jimmy McGrory, he said, "Well, we're signing you." So I had to get in touch with Fauldhouse United then. Mm-hmm. And they came in the phone and meet. So I signed there and then. That was me and the team. Actually, I took over for John Bonner. Mm-hmm. Bonner left 58. So they were only left with two keepers. Mm-hmm. It was Big Haffey and Dick Beattie. Mm-hmm. So I came in as the third keeper. Within a year, I was in the first team.
So you mentioned Jimmy McGrory there. Like, yeah. What kind of place was Celtic Park these days? Because McGrory in later years was painted as being a figurehead
chairman.
Only, but the chairman was a powerful man.
Oh,
is that the feeling you got at the time?
Aye. But old Jimmy Gribben had a good input to the team. Mm-hmm. Jimmy Gribben brought a lot of good players in.
He was a coach.
He was a second team physio. Mm-hmm. Sponge man, he was really a sponge man. Mm-hmm. And Jimmy had a lot of input to the players in the way back then too. Mm-hmm. If Jimmy watches you and he likes you, you've got a good report in. Mm-hmm. That was you. Mm-hmm. So we gave a good report in, and that was me on the road.
So even before Steen took over, there was wee buds beginning.
Big Jock had came then as a coach.
Mm-hmm. Oh aye, in the
reserves. That's right. Jock was staying as over. So that was the start of the Kelly kids. Mm-hmm. Now we won the treble a couple of years in the trot, you know.
In the reserves?
The reserves, we cleared up everything. Mm-hmm. A great reserve team. So when Evans and Peacock and all them were moving out, nearly Malcolm was left back when I went in. And I played in the opening of the floodlights.
Not Wolves?
Wolves. Mm-hmm. And it was myself, Fallon, Mackay, Malcolm.
Crem.
It was Crern, Evans and Peacock. Mm-hmm. And then up front we had, again,
a mishmash, wasn't it?
Oh, it was mishmash. McVitie's was playing, Jackson, Conway, Lockhead. You didn't know who was mishmash, you know. And
it was a shame, because a lot of the boys might have become real stars if they had a good manager to guide them, and the club had been more organised at the time, tactically.
Well, Big Joke just left about, 60, what? 60?
60.
About 60, that's right. He went to the firm and saved them for relegation. Mm-hmm. And then he came to Park Eden, beat us in the cup, wasn't it?
You weren't in the final, though, were you?
I was called in that day. Mm-hmm. I got a message, you better come in.
This is 61, isn't it?
Mm-hmm. Half he was injured.
Aye.
Well, he said he was injured. Mm-hmm. And I walked in, and all of a sudden he says, "No, I'm fit."
And that was you done out of final place.
So that was me done out of the final. That was the replay I'm talking about.
Oh, the replay. Right. That was a right mucky wet night that night, wasn't it?
Well, we went to Tynecastle, and wee Bertie went to Tynecastle, and that was wee Bertie's last game for Celtic when he went to
the second time.
Because he'd been away to Dumbarton before that.
Oh, right, three times for Bertie, isn't it?
So he was punted out. Uh-huh. And we beat Hearts. I couldn't believe this result getting beat. I think he'd won about 6-1 or something. We came back to Glasgow, and we came into Ferraris, and Bob Kelly turned and said, "I will let the boys enjoy themselves." And Big Joe then he came back 64, but we had a mismatch again.
Well, what I was going to say, it was there that even before Steen came, that there was wee buds beginning to blossom, you know.
That's,
I mean,
right.
Murdoch was, I know he wasn't in the right position, but
that's right.
Big Yogi was making a name for himself, and you were all fairly young men. I don't think
that's
there
right.
was anybody particularly experienced.
18, 19 when we were in the first team. I was 19 when we were in the first team.
So you go to the final of the Cup Winners Cup against MTK Budapest, which was...
Semi-final, aye.
Did I say the final? So
semi-final.
Now, that was some achievement at that point.
It was great.
And we were 3-0 up for the first leg, so what I was going to say is, what went on in the second leg?
Just go out and play the same. That was the instructions.
No tactics,
no just,
talk.
You know how to do it, boys. Just do your job and that's it, you know. But make sure you get forward and do this and do that. Well, they got, I think, two dodgy penalties. I know they got a bad dodgy penalty. I think we'd scored a couple and never been there. Oh, it was a homer. And we'd no chance of winning it. You get that feeling, you know, after a couple of minutes, you say, oh, this is going to be a disaster. You know, it was like my first game in Europe was Valencia, or there.
62.
I went there as a pampered boy, you would say. And sitting out on the beach, enjoying the sun at night. And wee Doc Fitzsimmons came out and says, what are you doing here? I says, enjoying the sun. He says, no, you're not, you're playing. And Bob Kelly was sitting. He says, what? You're playing. Frank Haffey's got asthma or something. Mm-hmm. He's got, what? So that was me, and that was I'll never forget that experience as well.
4-2.
Aye. Mm-hmm. Getting pelted with oranges as well. Oh, that Masana Stadium. Animals.
That right?
First I experienced animals.
Oh,
and they were one great team. They'd already won the Fair Cities Cup. They were the holders. Oh, and they gave us a right doing. You know, you don't mind getting beat, but some of their tactics as usual, you know. But then, as you said, Budapest, we just kept playing the same way, you know.
I mean, that could have been a big achievement getting to the final.
You could have played a hand in the final too. I think the hand didn't. The final was at
64, try to think.
I think the final was it Liverpool got beat in the final?
No, it was 66 when we get beat by Liverpool.
I'm sure we could have played it and in the final day.
You might be right, that'd be something to check.
No, I'd need to check that. I can't remember.
So, when Steen came in 65, everybody's on the up because they realised for the first time we're going to have a real manager.
Aye.
So, as a player, what was your first impression?
Well, we knew right away, that's us.
On our way.
We're on our way, we've got in. You don't have an idea what the team's going to be. The only thing is, we didn't know when Murdy was going to play. But Murdy, sometimes, you know, if you think back, we used to play Murdy inside right, and he was lost.
Really?
He was lost. Bobby was needed to start back and see the game. And for some reason, he played that a couple of times. And Bobby was lost, utterly lost, and got beat. But when Bobby was midfield, that was it. You needed Bobby in the middle of the park.
Aye.
When the big man came, his first game, check the first game, I think. One of the first games, we got humped with Hibs. We got slaughtered at Celtic Park with Hibs this night, Wednesday night. And we came off the park, and I was like, oh, it's all good. I'm going to get bollocking. This is going to be murder now. The big man will get right through you. And we came in. We're all sitting down, and the big man turned around and says, that's our lesson, and that's the way we're going to be playing. We played Hibs a couple of weeks later, and we horsed him at Easter Road.
Total reverse.
He just went back to our old style of playing football. The way he had everything working as a unit. And that was how, then for, you know, we just knew that was it. It was straight ahead.
So how would how was Steen with goalkeepers then? Was there any specialised goalkeeping coach in any days?
He used to batter a boy for
just shoot practice. That was nothing any great talks of it.
He'd warm you up with a couple of shots, you know, on your goals, moving your boot and catching the ball, and then he'd have other players hammering the ball for half an hour, constant, and then crosses, everything. That was your goalkeeping.
And you had a difficult relationship with Big Jock. Did that come later? Were you okay at that point?
Nah, it was a funny relationship I had for Jock. I just don't know. I don't know. He didn't like goalkeepers. That, you know, I always blamed the goalkeeper for everything.
Because you had a book out in Keeping it paradise.
Well, I wanted to.
You wanted to call it something?
Blame the goalie.
That'd have been funny.
And because always blame the goalie. Okay, you have your bad games and all that. Everybody's had a bad game and all that, but. Say at the time, it was just. I don't think you ever say to me, well done.
Not even after a good game?
No. You know, the Real Madrid game, I was just reading it on a couple of times on it was on Facebook, somebody put it on Facebook today. The teams just coming out to a partner and everybody's talking about wee Jimmy and wee Jimmy. And I'm saying to myself, the wee Jimmy day, wee Jimmy's just done his usual. I have to keep the ball out the net.
There's one save you actually see on film that's a brilliant save. A guy cuts the ball back, it's point blank.
Aye.
And hammers it, and you threw yourself, and he actually smothered that you held it.
Aye, well, I was going the wrong way, and it's a twist.
But when you see that in film, you think, Christ, what a save.
And then there's another one, there's another one, it was to the back post. And I went back, running with my back up, and I went up, horizontal.
So after a game like that, you wouldn't even have said, well done, big man.
I remember. I was walking in the tunnel. At the Barnabo, and Bob Kelly was standing at the end of it, and he turned around and says, well done, John. And Big Joe turned around and said, that's what you're fucking paid for. When I went, I just looked at him, and that was war.
Well, the 65 Cup final was the start of the glory era. So
that's right.
For a young guy like yourself who's craving success, and a club like Celtic who have went so far without success, what was your memories of that day?
Just the elation of winning the cup.
But was your emotions no torn because Dunfermline were 1-0 and 2-1 up though?
Oh aye, they went 1-up. The ball came in, I remember going for it and I shouted and I went up to punch it and Ian Young was leaning in. But I got my hand here and I punched it out a good 20-30 yards out towards the right hand side, and I looked, me Harry Miller was just standing himself and they picked him up, so he just came in bang. So if I'm in the road out as I get back, nobody went back to cover. And he just, the ball went into the end. The second goal, I've lined up the ball.
Second goal was a good shot though, wasn't it?
I've got to blame me that. I've lined it up, and when you see it from behind the goals, you see the ball going like that. And Big John McLaughlin must have been waiting for it. And then we got the corner kick, a goal, and that was it. And 5-6 minutes, it's a wee bit tense. You know, well, please keep them out, keep them out. And I always remember, I thanked Inverleigh Cars at Hampden because they all sat in front of the nurse enclosure. We managed to go, got a goal kick, or even a I put two into the dugouts at the stand side, and I must have put about three in a hint of the Inverleigh Cars, because the ball boys couldn't get in and the ball they had to climb out
and it takes longer
and they said, get in there out the road. And that was wasting time putting it in the side game.
So how did you lose your you were the goalkeeper in 65 and Ronnie Simpson was there at the time. Aye. So how did you lose your place? Was it a loss of form or injury or what?
No, he blamed me. Is it a semi-final or something?
Who against?
I can't remember. Was it Airdrie? Air United, we not play with Air United about three times in the semi-final of the League Cup. And I got to blame with the game. And then even the second year, I think Ronnie came in, that was him. For that, you know, he came in after that.
And he got a run.
He got a run to his injury.
That's and right.
Then I got back in again.
So that takes us up to Lisbon, and you've got there's all these fables about legends, if you like, about Lisbon, and one of them is that you chase Herrera and off the bench.
That's right.
You get sent out with Neil Mulcahy.
We were walking out, if you see the film, we're walking out, and you see me, a friend of mine had gave us this beer, and Big Joe says, get that bench. So I had to run. You see me breaking ranks and going up and sitting down, and the Portuguese police are stoning. And I went, Celtic, and they went, and Herrera's come up with some henchmen. I said, oh, you get. Move it. And the police are saying, move. Get up. So Herrera wasn't too pleased.
So what was the preference for the bench? Was it nearer the pitch or was it
just in halfway line?
Halfway line, the better view.
Aye, because they were pushed up about the 18 yard line. So Big Joe wanted there so he could see better. That was all. I just said, get that bench. And I don't know if it's what I'm upmanship as well, you know.
I suppose so.
That was a highlight to.
So the thing is, there's 12 Lisbon Lions because you get a medal. So you did it as a substitute, which I don't think people appreciate, that you were the official substitute player in those days for being a goalkeeper.
A lot of them don't believe it, you know. And he took my medal off me that night as well.
Who did?
Steve.
Who for?
He said it was, what was it? They forgot the referee's medal. And I looked at him a bit later years after I knew it. He gave it to Bob Kelly, and I got a dummy one.
And what have you got now?
A dummy one.
A dummy one?
No, all my medals are at Celtic Park. I flogged them into Celtic Park, so I don't know. I was really, when I found out, I went,
Well, that's a bit sad you didn't get keeping your real medal.
Disgusted with it.
So, the Real Madrid, and we've touched upon that, a lot of people say that was your greatest game. Would you agree with that?
No,
Di Stefano's testimonial.
It was a good game. I played well. A lot of good games I played at Parkhead. You know, I meet a lot of men and say, "Oh, John, I remember you against such and such and such, Slovan Bratislava when we got beat by, what do you call it, MTK."
MTK, aye, that season.
He says, "I remember you playing there. You kept us in the thing, mate, and you kept us with MTK. No MTK, Slovan Bratislava, and who was the other team? Dynamo Zagreb."
They were good teams.
They were good teams. And they said, "Oh, you played well in the ones as well." But a lot of games you don't get. They don't tell you anything. Excuse me a minute, tell you this. Come on, your substitute. Esther, put that dog in. Keep her in there. She's got too much to say for herself. And you know, you play a lot of games. One of my best games ever was, I was only 19. We drew 3 each at Easter Road. It was a Willie Jones, Bobby Johnson was playing, Joe Baker. That's a good team. Who else was playing? We Ormond was still playing. And the other day, have you fun it?
Aye, I was listening to that radio Clyde there.
What? You're just excommunicated.
They are taught, I've never heard so much shite in my life. And then, Soldier's Boy comes on.
Who?
Oh, I like for Safe Blanton. Derek goes, "Ah, you Soldier's Boy." He talks as much shite as his father.
Ah, well, so does Derek. He put me right off it, didn't he?
No, you thought that Real and the Bernabeu, and he said you played a lot of good games.
I'm not again, you know, you don't. As long as you were winning, that was, you know, that was the thing. You try to keep the goals out. You know, we had a hard time up to 65 with the fans. You know, they weren't again. It's like the new.
Frustration.
And there was a lot of changes, chopping and changing. No, when you look at some of the, I'm a mate, we're Stephen, every book I get in here about Celtic, he takes them. And somebody will phone me up, "John, hey, can you," I go to sit and think, he's away with my 80s Ed book, he's away with another 50s. And I used to just sit up and say, "Aye, it was such and such." And
look it up.
Look it up, but I've got to phone him now and say, "Can I get by?" And they're all great games, you know, hard games, you know.
So that, after being the European champions, that gave us the opportunity to go to South America, which was a bitter experience.
Yes, now, my friends have been on to me about it.
Well, we all know what happened, but what I want to ask you is, did you get fined as part of the team? Because you as a goalkeeper wouldn't have been involved in any of the shenanigans that were happening outfield play, but did you get fined?
Originally get fined.
Right.
But then they just...
They waved it?
Waved it.
Because that would have been unfair, you know, you weren't involved in it.
Jim Craig and I, because Jim Craig fought a corner. I said, "What are you blaming us for?" I said, "Been nothing to do with it."
And yet you were on the bench, and then when Ronnie got injured and the warm up. Was that the first game or the second game?
First
game. So you played in both games.
I played in both games.
And looking back, the Racing Club, for all that they were the shenanigans, were a decent
team.
They
were a great team.
So they didn't really need to rely on that, did they?
No, I did. In fact, I've not got the emails now, have I? It's some team. See, there's a boy from South America working with him, PR man, it was saying to me, I've been looking through history and I noticed you're on Facebook and I've seen you on Twitter.
Mm-hmm.
He said, that's the same man, he's just been looked at your history.
Mm-hmm.
How do you time it? I enjoy it. You know, the set games, I'll tell you what,
the second game was in Uruguay, it wasn't because it was a playoff.
See, the first game, it was tough, it was hard. What do you expect for South American teams at the time, right?
And they were the champions of South America. Aye. So
you were looking for the odd scratch and kick and all that. The second game was just a shambles.
Mm-hmm.
But both teams was to blame for the second game, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But typical BBC, or they lambasted us.
They really went through us.
It was
cute with how they edited the highlights, I think, weren't they?
Aye.
To make it look as if he were as bad as it.
That's right. But in hindsight, the game wasn't really as bad. Was it Airdrie a couple of weeks ago, up at Airdrie there? I'm stunning. Behind the goals, and they started singing. I was right behind where these boys were all singing the songs. And the dirtiest game you've ever seen.
I say, and that refers to that game.
And I said to them, they've not seen dirty games. And this boy says, what do you mean? I says, Atletico Madrid was 100 times worse. I says, 100 times. I says, we've had some terrible games since South America.
Mm-hmm.
I says, South America was bad, but wasn't it never as bad as what they all made out.
Mm-hmm. And yet there must have been a sense of disappointment as well, because that would have been something to claim to be champions of the world.
We try to claim it in away goals.
Well, that's the point.
Away goals came in, but they wouldn't accept UEFA or FIFA. That was a big
debate.
Mm-hmm. That was a really big debate, that, you know. But I enjoyed it, you know. Mm-hmm. Great experience.
So the good times were in full flow. And when Ronnie got his injury, you won the treble in 69.
That's right.
And there's another game that you're fondly remembered for, was the Fordnut Cup final against Rangers, because everybody remembers Conway's goal and Big Billy Seedy in the first minute. But I've seen that game, the 90 minutes here, and number one, it was a roughhouse game.
Oh, aye.
Right? And number two, but even when it was 1-0 and 2-0, you made 2 or 3 cracking saves.
Mm-hmm.
And at that point, the game had a change if Rangers had a goal.
Mm-hmm.
There was one particular one, another point blank effort, Willie Johnson had it.
No, it was Orange Person.
Orange Person.
No, Orange Person.
Orange Person.
That's what you called him. Orange Person.
So again.
And Fergie put the boot into me.
I remember that. Aye.
And Murdy dragged them out the road, and then the last 20 minutes, Sam and Murdy were at each other.
Were they? All game?
Right. And Fergie, you know, I blame Fergie for my injury. And he said, what do you mean? I said, how about you? He said, you forget, you punched me in the back about 3 times. So you go up my road. You shouldn't have been standing in front of me. Because, see, that, you know, a goalkeeper to come out and defend yourself.
And that was a rough game, because the one thing about Celtic you need to say nowadays is, they were a wonderful football team, but I think one of the strengths of that team is that if you tried it on,
guys
like Bertie and Bobby Murdoch, Jim Brogan, Tam Gemmell and all that, they were shy.
That's right.
Neither they were. But that was a game that you're fondly remembered for. Did you not get any credit? Do you feel you never get credit for that?
No, I kind of.
At the time?
No, I just remember walking off, and Big Billy coming up, but Jim, Craig and Big Billy, the three of us walked over the park at the same time, and it was thinging me on my back, and the Celtic supporters were chanting my name and all that, and I felt like turning around and saying, yeah, sure, bastards. You forget about, you know, for about a year before, you know, because twice I was brought in at the last minute, two Rangers games, I'll never forget, two each and one, nothing.
Well, we'll get into that in a wee minute, I've got that penned in, in Milan in 1970, were you the sub goalie?
That's a sore point with me.
But were they sub goalie that night?
I got dropped.
Evan was in the team maybe just a few months before.
We'll just forget that then, eh?
I know. But what I'm saying is that another European Cup final that you were on the bench?
That's another one I'd fell out with him.
And it was two poor goals that night?
Aye. And he kept looking at me. I kept saying, you fucking picked the team. Well, you just flew the whole football at me.
Did you see that to
him?
So I mean, you can't blame Evan Williams personally, but the first one in particular was weak. So was he just wrapped under the bar? The second
one was worse.
That was Billy's fault, though. So
the referee let him away.
The
referee let Billy away with 2 penalties. And see me watch it. It's like that.
I know.
And I just sat. I didn't even know there were medals gave out that night.
Have you heard that, Menno?
No, never even meant for it. No. I walked in, put my clothes on, walked out. Said, I'll get out of the roadie here.
Mm-hmm. So that brings us on to there's a game that you mentioned it there, the 2-8 game against Rangers.
I mean,
you feel like the
game that we won to get into that final, I think, was when we beat Benfica.
Oh, 3-0. Especially over there when we got a bit of a pasted in the second leg.
Oh.
We had to hang on, didn't we?
I had another great game and I got to blame it after that.
Mm-hmm.
I was drunk.
Mm-hmm.
I was drunk for that, I went.
Mm-hmm.
I went, oh, I just did words and that was that. I didn't take any managers there.
Enough. So I know that I spoke to you the other day there on the phone and we were talking about the 2-8 game against Rangers in 6-8. Now, for anybody that isn't aware of it, the two goals that Rangers scored that day, and rightly or wrongly, you took the rap for it.
Aye.
Right?
The first one, I could definitely take the rap because it was like, was it Rab Douglas, remember?
Oh, aye.
Through the legs.
Mm-hmm. So was that Lloyd Johnson's goal?
Diving out with your head.
Mm-hmm.
Instead of going down on the side, it'd never been a goal. Mm-hmm. But I went down, leaning forward, and I went right through my legs. I went, And I looked at the gun, and it was fucking the warming up.
Mm-hmm.
You know, one each then, Bobby scored 2-1.
Mm-hmm.
And then the last kick of the ball's up at their penalty box. And I think it was Billy Ritchie, rolled it out to Kai Johansson.
He's a right back.
He ran the full length of the park.
Mm-hmm.
Nobody tackled him. I'm shouting, get out, stop him, get out.
Mm-hmm.
And by this time, they all came on, backing off.
Right in front of you?
Right in front of me. And the ball's hit. I was going to my right hand side. So I'm anticipating the ball going that way and I'm watching it. And then the next thing, the ball's went on my shoulder, is it? That's just, that ball's swerve. Surely, I always had it in my mind that the ball swerved.
Mm-hmm.
You know, mm-hmm. the way you hit it.
It's
a deflection. It's on TV.
Mm-hmm.
Somebody shows you and it's hit somebody's shoulder.
Mm-hmm.
And went the opposite way because it's deflected too quick.
Mm-hmm.
But I had to put my hands up for the tape.
Mm-hmm.
And then you get hurted with ex players writing a book saying, right after the game, I was laughing and whistling and singing. What a shite. I tried to drink. I could have drunk myself in the bath that day. I was that fucking disgusted. But what I really annoyed nobody knows the story. That year the games were changed the 1st of January.
Mm-hmm.
It was always a game against Rangers. Clyde were in the league at the time, so they decided to take it away for the 1st of January. I would be drunk to try to save trouble.
Sorry.
No, try to save trouble with the fans.
Yeah.
So I went to Shawfield. I was playing at Shawfield. I was told I was playing at Shawfield. Ronnie would play the next day.
Mm-hmm.
Right, you accepted it. I said, well, I've got a chance. If I go out there and get a right good game, maybe change his mind.
Mm-hmm.
We got to Shawfield. Everything was all right. Boots was all ready, all lined up. Strips all lined up. Went in, and all of a sudden, he changed his mind. And Ronnie played, and Ronnie looked at me, and I went, oh no. And that's what he said. And for some reason he was injured. And Big Joke says, ah, don't worry about him, he's kidding on.
Mm-hmm.
So we went next day, parkade sitting, the early kick-off. As I said, we were sitting in the table tennis, we used to just look at his table tennis room. About 1:15 to go for the kick-off.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody's ready. Oh, upstairs and got a seat, and he just battered the door open and just spun around and says, you. And they're a nice way of talking to people, you know. Yeah. And I looked at him and said, I'm up in there. And I walked in into the dressing room, everybody's getting ready, and I walked in looking, no goalie. I said, what the fuck's going on here? And when he's in the shower room, the bath, no, that.
Mm-hmm.
And I could hear him, ah. And he come out with his clothes on. And look, Big Joe says, right, get ready, you're playing. And I always remember the referee walking in to check the boots.
How long before kick-off is this?
10 minutes.
Oof. That's not much preparation time there, is it?
Mentally, you know. Mm-hmm. I went, oh, fuck, I've done it before. Mm-hmm. You know, I played the Celtic, you're playing that, like South America as well. And so I played. And exactly a year later, at Ibrox, the same thing happened.
Most won all that day, didn't we?
The penalty kick.
Mm-hmm. Greg?
And I says, they'll both fucking get by me the day.
Mm-hmm.
And I was having a right good game too.
So you see the same thing happened. Ronnie pulls out at the last minute.
Aye.
And you got called in late on.
Aye. And I remember him saying to me, don't have any, we'll no have the same as last. Can you move your mother up and say that? That's fucking nice to say to Andy.
Mm-hmm.
And I just looked. And I remember the wee dog Fitzsimmons just shrugged his shoulders. And Bob Kelly. As if something Bob and the wee dog just shrugged his shoulders. And old Bob just walked out. You're walking out, but Bob says, all the best.
What was that?
And that's it, and then the time up, it's a penalty kick, so I couldn't get blamed for that.
Mm-hmm.
I went, fuck, oh my God, that must be a jinx. And that's how I was glad then, like, when we got them in the final.
Aye, you made up for it, didn't it?
Then the three games in the drop, when we beat them 1-9, twice at Ibrox and once at Parkade, when Slim Jim came back or something.
Mm-hmm. That's right, Jim Craig got sent off at Ibrox in the
wee bass,
the league game. Wally Johnson.
Aye. Mm-hmm.
That's not like Craig to lose his temper.
Big Jim just walked off, and I can't remember if it was what Tiny Worms the referee.
Mm-hmm.
It was. And Billy and Jim walked all the way across, and it happened up at their end.
That's right. That's right.
And he walked right across, and
he was peeling.
He was peeling. And I don't know. I think Tiny Wharton said, "I'm sorry." And just fit with him.
Mm-hmm.
That's why I said, "I'm sorry, Mr. Craig.
You're off." That was a shame.
But in fairness, Wharton, I think, put his report in.
Mm-hmm.
And when Jim Craig went up, he was reprimanded.
Mm-hmm.
And Johnson went up not that long after. Did he get an 8-game suspension?
Mm-hmm. Well, he was always getting sent off, Johnson.
I think he got one of the longest.
Aye, the suspensions ever.
And that was in the back of their minds when he'd done. But remember the 8 games, you know, there was, you know, the Sons of Truth man.
Who's that?
Craig.
Houston.
Harry Houston. He stayed next door to my daughter, doing it from Saget. And he says to me, and they worked at Ford, so he got me a motor, and I said, oh, thanks, Craig. Get this motor, big man.
Mm-hmm.
Right, I says, aye, I'll get the C-Max, it was just coming out to the market. I says, aye. And he got me a silver one. I says, Craig, that's a lovely one, that green one. So the next one, I ordered this green one, and it came through hall. And I always remember him saying something about, oh, well, John, I'll need to show you this. And downstairs toilet, that's the fucking brain of us. The wee toilets you've got downstairs in these new houses. And up in the wall. Two programmes, Celtic vs Rangers.
In the loo?
In the loo. And I don't know if he put them up just because I was.
Mm-hmm.
And he said, I'm going to show you these. He says, hey, my dad gave me them. He says, oh, what days they were? I'm going, 69, 70. You're right.
They were great days, not for him, but for you.
They were great days. you were playing. I says, that's right. The Jim Craig no score in the last minute in that game, and Big Tam scored in the last minute in that game.
Mm-hmm.
I said, to make it worse at Hamden, Parkade, I think Harry Hood scored in the last minute of the game. I said, we won nothings against you. Boy,
that'd be him raging.
Boy, I've never seen him tackle. I'd love to meet him there.
So, when Evan Williams came in, That spelled then for you, because you know, like, you were getting on years, and you know, maybe Steen had other things in mind. So when the departure, when it came to leave,
well, he wouldn't sell me.
Mm-hmm.
I know there was 3 English clubs in for me.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that when Evan Williams came, it was against Benfica.
Mm-hmm.
He was up.
That was the long after, that's right.
He was up that night.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And Tommy Docherty was the manager of as in Vanilla, as I call them. And Evan was on loan for Wolves.
Mm-hmm.
And I know that later on, apparently, the doc says the doc offered a big bit of money for you. He said, I'll give you Williams and I'll take him, but of course, I'll give you money. He said, but didn't this a big joke? If you read Big Yogi's book, you'll find out. And Willie Wallace's book, you find out.
Because maybe a sad thing for a fan's perspective is like he deserves to go with a wee bit of dignity, and it didn't always happen, as you said there, with Big Yogi and Willie. And especially Bobby Murdoch, people that didn't want to go particularly still had good years in them. So
John Gorman.
I know.
He was raging when John Gorman went for Carlisle.
To Spurs
for over £1 million. He was fucking raging. He must have been looking to see how much he could have thingmed. But I know there were three English clubs in for me. He pulled me out of the 69, he pulled me out of the Scotland squad to play at Wembley, and Jim Herriot got in that week. And I was also picked to.
When you say he pulled you, he wouldn't let you play, or he put that in the Kybers?
Kybers. And then things got really bad when I found out that he'd done the same with the Irish squad.
You could have done a Charlie Gallagher, is that what you're saying?
Charlie got kicked out because of it. Charlie was the same.
Now, Charlie's pretty. We've had a talk with Charlie, and I know he's pretty bitter about the way things turned out, but it shows you the power that managers wield in the days when things like that could happen, and the lack of publicity as well, because in the modern age you can't hide nothing.
No.
Whereas in the days you could keep a lid on it.
They were all fairly seen, the press.
Oh, aye.
They were fairly. And in fact, when I finished up, it was 8 weeks in the hospital. Except the semi-I had. And I came out and I played. My last game was against Aberdeen, got beat 1-0. And that was me. I'd been out again for a full year. They brought me back into the team. I played two or three games and I said, this is good. And Aberdeen, and there's a famous photo of me having a go at Joe Harper.
Me Harper, that's right. I grabbed him by the throat, didn't
you? Aye. And then Monday morning, the record had it in their mind. So I was sitting. I had a good game to. And he came in. And he said, that's the last time you'll ever fucking do that to MD in a good jersey. And then he came up, told me I was going to Motherwell. In fact, I was at training on Monday morning, and I left. I met Bobby Murdoch, and Bobby says, he's looking for you. I said, fuck off. No, I'm looking for him. So I just don't take that shite. And he says, he's looking for you. I said, for now, he says, I think he's selling you. He says, what? I'm not going. So I was sitting in the house, the other house, and Esther was sitting. And she says, yeah, he's coming to your house. I said, leave him. I'm chatting the door. My mother's sitting at the side. She said, well, don't dare, bring him in. I said, what are you wanting? He says, you're going to Motherwell. I said, no. You're going to Motherwell, I said. I said, well, I'm fucking telling you, I'm not going anywhere. He says, look, you're going to Motherwell. I says, I'm not going. And he turned around and he says to me, no, there's a trouble with you. He says, you're a fucking bigot.
What do you mean by that?
Because of my background and fucking. See, there was also a hymn my fair had words years ago.
Oh, right.
So in the pits.
Background, that.
And he knew that I was right. My family was right after the Irish. And I said, well, if I'm a fucking bigot, I'm a true bigot, you know. I said, no, you tell me, I know what be you. And it went on, and Esther just stood up. She says, excuse me, Mr. Steen, out my house now. Get out my house. That was the last I ever spoke to him.
And he did go to Motherwell?
I went up to Motherwell in a couple of months, you know. But I know that he turned me down for going to England. I'd have rather went to England than anywhere else. I didn't want to go anywhere.
I know your heart wasn't in it, obviously.
I just wasn't in it playing in Scotland. You
were maybe a bit too old for the move to England. But
I was 31 at the time.
I wasn't that old, but
you know. But just, you know, the badness was there.
And what I said to Charlie Gallagher as well is, did you ever meet Steen in later years? Was there ever any...
There was trouble.
No, but what I was hoping for, you were going to say, is maybe he's made up, because there's no point in holding grudges.
There's a... Remember the Inter Milan game?
72.
Penalty kick. And I went in, and Big Yogi walked in front of me.
Could you get me a Diet Coke? You want mine, son?
No, thanks.
You sure?
Oh, no, honestly. I understand.
Drive you in there.
No, no, honestly, thank you.
They're near there.
I'm trying to stay off it for Lent, to be honest.
You bet?
I'm trying to stay off it for Lent, to be honest.
Right.
Okay. Right, just a deal,
isn't it? I went in, the big yogi walked by me. I said, big man, I'll see you in a minute. He said, aye, right. So he was at Crystal Palace at the time.
Mm-hmm.
And I went up to the front door, and Bill Peacock went like that to me.
He was a front door man, wasn't he?
Mm-hmm. Went like that to me, stop. Right. You're not allowed in. I said, what? ex-players are not allowed in. I said, wait a minute. So Freedom just walked in there. He said, but you're not allowed in. And that was that. Never set foot in Celtic Park. For about 7 years, was banned.
Mm.
But he didn't know. I used to go in the free. See the season book? The wee wicker basket.
Aye, aye.
Wee gate. I used to go in there and sit away in the...
At the road.
At the road.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And he probably wouldn't know it was there, but...
Mm-hmm.
And it was one day, Big Billy had came back me. Aberdeen, and he, John Clark phoned me. I said, oh, what is it, John? He said, I want to see you. I went, and he said, what is it? He says, two medals in here belong to you.
Aye.
I said, what was it? He says, league championships. He said, people don't know where they are now. He says, they're there. 1 minute, he says, they're away. I said, ah, well, somebody deserves them better than me then, if that's their.
Mm-hmm,
mm-hmm. And he, what's the score of you? Pain to get into the games.
Mm.
I says, well,
I'm a supporter.
I'm a supporter, but I'm not allowed. He says, hey, you know, Big Billy came in. He says, bump, two tickets, a white one.
Complimentary.
For the season. Mm-hmm. And one so that I could get in the front door.
Mm-hmm.
And that was after 6 years.
That's good that you get the, at least somebody
aye.
Thought well of your service.
Because you knew that I was going to the games, you know.
That's right.
Uh-huh. But
that was a nice thing to do.
That was animosity. I never ever made it up. In fact, the day he died, when he died, his funeral, I wasn't going to his funeral.
Mm-hmm.
And I always admired Big Yogi for it. Never went.
John, no go, no.
No.
I suppose there's no point in being a hypocrite.
That's mm-hmm. what I felt.
Mm-hmm.
And Esther and I had words. I said, I'm no going.
Mm-hmm.
I said, the man and I just never got on. I says, he made my life hell. I says, I'm sorry. She says, no, you're gone. Just for your own satisfaction. I says, well, I wouldn't be satisfied. And I remember going in, and I don't think I spoke to Andy. I just said hello to a couple of them, jumped in the motor. And
Back.
In fact, I didn't even know I was done. And next day, Rod Stewart. But I think what made me worse was I seen Sooners there, and I said, I'm going to fuck. I seen a couple of them there and I went, oh, I'm off.
So after that you went into the pub trade.
Yep.
And you'd found Bad Blantyre.
That's right,
and did you never consider going into football management? Was that not an option?
It was a very difficult thing to get into.
Especially for an ex-goalkeeper, does he seem to be?
Not in my B licence.
Aye, aye.
I never went for my A licence. It was Andy Roxburgh and Craig Brown. Took me in for my A licence. You could skate this. And I got offered a job in South Africa,
mm-hmm.
America. Esther wouldn't go to any two of them. And then I got offered one in Cyprus. I'll never forget it. Malta and Cyprus. And the Cyprus one came up. And I said, right, we'll go. They were offering us a week. And we went to Stakis. All Rio Stakis was behind it.
Mm-hmm.
And I said to him, what's the score? He says, there's a man at this SFA coaching school with you. I said, hey, I can't remember his name. He says, hey, he's a Cypriot coach.
Mm-hmm.
And he wants you out there. But he wants you to take a team
mm-hmm.
as well. I says, oh, that's interesting. He says, yeah, you'll have a house. Children will be educated at the
English school.
a car. And you'll be on about maybe £150 a week. I says, so I'm just left to leave Celtic a year ago for 60 quid
mm-hmm.
and a separate team.
Mm-hmm.
Davy Hay went to Chelsea, didn't he?
Mm-hmm.
And war broke out in Cyprus, and that was it up there.
Mm-hmm.
And after that, I just said,
enough.
enough's enough.
So
I prefer watching Celtic.
I can understand that.
I'll take that job any day because it's an easy job.
Well, is it? It should be an easy job.
It is an easy job. If you can, say to the men what you want, if you kind of get it across, you know, maybe the system. I'd go three five two.
Well, we're going to dial in a wee minute because that's where we're going to finish. But just one other wee thing here before we go on is, you wrote your book recently, as we were talking about. Did you find it quite therapeutic talking about old times? Did you enjoy it? Has it been a good experience?
Well, I enjoyed it. And a lot of people's come back and said to me, well, I enjoyed your book, John. It's no, it's a different book for what other books
it's
a different system.
You're definitely opinionated in the book, whereas in some of the other books people skate over things, but you're not frightened to go in there and
fight.
Well, not so much fight, but like say what you believe, you know, rather than skate around the sides.
I've said to you a few people, you know, we ain't read the second one.
But overall, was it an enjoyable experience?
Aye. And I actually said that. I said, you know, I could write a second book. And a few of them would shite themselves if I wrote it and wrote what I...
But you really think?
What I really felt. You know, I was being kicked out the Lisbon Lions squad with a dispute with a certain man.
Is this in later years? Is this the financial stuff?
Aye.
Because I know that...
They didn't like it when I was made to go the go-between. I knew nothing about it on the 25th anniversary, and I got a phone call. Do you want me to bribe his phone? I said, oh, what is that? Do you know this? I says, no. I said, I don't know what's happening. Well, this is on and that's on and that. Yeah, he's doing this, they're doing that. I says, are you okay? He says, but wait a minute. I says, I know where you're going, Joe. I says, the 11 that played, weren't they? The full 11 that played in every game.
That's right.
I says, well, then you've had more games. Charlie Gallagher.
Joe.
Yourself. I says, I know where you're coming from.
A big yogi.
So that was the 16 years. I'm the only one that never kicked a ball. And if you ever go to Celtic Park, there's 40s there. I'm no in them.
No, you're not in any of them, that's right. And yet you were official sub, so...
That's how bad when they put me in a 40 to their 1-2, and Huey Burt says no. It's a 16 joke.
I want them on.
They're all in it. That hurt me too, but... So a lot of people don't know the Lisbon squad.
Well, for supporters like myself, and I'm talking...
Young boys didn't know I was a Lisbon Lion.
Well, I'm talking from my dad's era. The guys who supported you throughout the great years. Their idea of the Lisbon Lions was the squad.
That's right.
Because Joe McBride was revered. My old man loved Joe McBride.
Joe got injured at Christmas and he was top
37
four.
Goals or something like that before Christmas. Crazy. And Big Yogi was always a crowd favourite, and so they all played their part in it.
That's right, everybody played their part.
So although the 11 guys took the limelight on the day,
that's right,
might not have got there without the contribution of other people.
That's what I said. There was 15 played and there were 16 in the pool, and that was the only one that ever played. I said, but I played two games in the World Club Championship games.
That's right.
I said, but it was the order he'd a medal. I was supposed to have got a medal. And selling these medals. I said, no. I says, I wasn't doing it. It's your medal. I says, it can't be my medal. And I went on and on and on. And he says, I'm telling you, you'll never get invited to another Lisbon Lion thing. I said, well, no fucking bother me then. I said, I don't need it. And it was the medal. He didn't know that my medals are at Celtic Park. And I found out it was his medal. But I don't want to.
Well, it's not worth saying,
isn't it? I don't want to even talk about him.
So,
and even the golf, I don't get invited to the golf outings.
Was there a big do every year?
Well, they played a few. I went to Carrick 1 year. I was invited 1 year and I went down. I think it was second, the team I played in. So the following year, I was at the Carrick and I got a phone call from a pal of mine. He said, John, we're playing at the Carrick tomorrow. I says, oh, yes, it's all good. He said, you know, go on. I says, no, I've not been invited. He says, that's what I'm phoning you for. I said, okay then. Him and a bank manager and an airport pilot. That was the 4 years. And we won it. Never invited back. That's how fucking childish they are.
It's pretty poor as well now, because
you know, they're childish.
You know, the older we get, they're all dying off, and for the supporters, they're still, you know, got them in a pedestal.
I know,
and it's a shame.
You know, and go back to what Joe done, but you know, he phoned me and I said, "Look, Joe, I want nothing to do with it."
Mm.
He said, "No, look, you're our official 12th man." I said, "You wouldn't know with Big Joe and the voties."
Mm-hmm.
"Oh, you'll need to do something. The yogi's kicking up hell about it." I said, "Well, leave it with me." And I said, "What the fuck am I going to phone?" And I phoned wee hockey, wee Wally.
Mm-hmm.
I says, "Wally, do you know what's going on?" He says, "I know what's going on." He said, "Do you?" I says, "What do you mean?" He says, "It's only 11. And Wally says, "It's what?" He said, "No, 16.
Mm-hmm.
I said, "No, it's only the 11 they want. And if you remember, Alec Cameron, the Daily Record, made a film doing it. Seamill Hydro.
Seamill,
and they were sitting blabbing away about, oh, we were this and you were that. Mm. And Bogan Murdoch says, "Hold on. We played." He said, "It was a squad team."
Mm-hmm.
"John Fallon was official in the team." Mm-hmm. "Jim Craig says he was official." He says, "And we did our four men."
Mm-hmm.
And that rocked the boat a wee bit.
Mm-hmm.
That was just at the start of the 25th anniversary.
Mm.
And I really rocked the boat, didn't I, when I phoned. And I phoned, I think Peter Lowell had been there at the time, would he?
No, before him.
Was it just before him? I know I phoned somebody else.
Mm.
I said, "I'm not fucking happy about this."
Mm.
I says, "I've been asked to speak up for them."
Mm.
And it did cause...
Mm-hmm. A bit of grief.
A bit, you know, a bit of resentment. You know, they think they're... up there, but okay, it's like any team, you know. But okay, they won the cup, you can't take that away for the 11th, it was on the part.
Yeah,
there's a lot of hard games played before it. Vojvodina, last minute goals, and all that. You forget about these games, you know.
I know,
so it's just your luck of the draw.
So that brings us on to we've touched on the current Celtic side. So I know you still go to the games because I see you before the game sometimes standing outside parking. So what's your opinions on the current lot?
That current lot, I could make a great team.
There is something they're trying to get out of them.
And I watched it on Saturday again. And I noticed the last 2 weeks, I know they're criticising the boy like hell, Johansson.
Mm-hmm.
But in the last two games, he's been playing further forward. And he's looked what he was at last season. And his passes haven't gone through. But they're trying to pass the ball through and the eye and needle.
Mm-hmm.
They're playing, trying to play that inch perfect Barcelona pass.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it goes by the boys.
That's
fitting,
right.
You know, the way we play it, the boys waiting for, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I said, just a wee bit wider. I said, because third goal we scored was brilliant.
Mm-hmm.
Because they ran at them. That's the Celtic style, running at them all the time. But we've got, who was it after Ross County? I was going to have my nut and grandstand. I said, "Grand, what are you doing?" It's the first time I'd walked out.
What game was that?
Ross County.
Oh, the semi-final.
Walked out 3 minutes to go. Oh, I don't believe this. I said, "We've got mere soft centres in that team than fucking Cadbury's cream eggs."
It used to be like if Celtic were down to 10 men and
you were
talking
about your team. We don't need somebody that could lift you with a throat. We'd have two men, you know, if you were down, you'd always somebody could carry you and say, "Right, boys, come on." And we'd fight to the end and we'd get the results.
And even if I didn't get the result, we go down with a fight.
We went down with a fight, but to go down with a wump.
I still think if Griffiths had scored the penalty that day, we might have got a draw, because
we'd have won.
See, the last 7 or 8 minutes,
we'd have won.
The crowd would have sucked about it, the goals, you know.
We'd have won that day.
The heads went down.
You know, it's terrible to think that Sevco, they're laughing at us because we kind of won a treble. During their 9 glorious thieving years, they won the treble once. They don't believe you.
I know.
You know, they don't believe you.
So what players impress you in the current team then? Who stands out for you? Well, let's talk about the goalkeeper then.
Last year. A couple of dodgy moments this year. I think he's was it Juventus when they set the 2 goals?
Inter Milan.
That was a turning point in him.
He's never been the same since, has he?
He's never been, but he's still there.
Mm.
And I like the other boy, Mm-hmm. I like the other boy too, because he commands, he's like Zaluska commanded his area better than, what do you call it?
Foster.
Foster as well.
Mm-hmm.
If he was a Foster stood in his line, I'd have got shot from that. 6'7".
Never came for a crossbow.
Never come for a crossbow. Now, Craig Gordon was coming for a lot of crossbows, and now he stopped.
Mm-hmm.
And I blame the coach. Other goalkeepers come for crossbows against us.
Mm-hmm.
You know that Saturday there, and last year when Inverness beat us, the semi-final again, wasn't it?
Hamden.
They scored two goals in the break for corner kicks for us.
Mm-hmm.
And on Saturday, we nearly lost a goal again for a corner kick. All the players is in our box.
Mm-hmm. The next thing you guys in the clear.
The boys who, and it was Griffiths against three of them. And the boy picked the wrong ball.
Mm-hmm.
See, if the boy picked the other, the right, mm-hmm. it was a goal.
Mm-hmm.
But he picked the boy on the left, and Griffiths put his tackle in.
Mm-hmm.
Which somebody says in BBC was looking for a penalty. I went, oh, I switch that off every week. You're in 5 minutes of Celtic and 10 minutes of moaning. Penalties and fouls.
I like to look at that boy Roberts.
He looks good.
We've been crying out for somebody like that for a few seasons now. Somebody that, as you say, there can run at people and commit defenders and
you've got a boy,
things up a wee bit.
You've got a boy asking for a transfer, and he was doing it 4 years ago.
Mm.
And now he's got into this. If you, that boy's going to go to England, he'll feel a harder tackle. You brush against him, he's going to do nothing for fouls.
Is this Forrest?
Forrest.
Mm-hmm. He's never really developed into the player we all hoped he was.
And if he thinks he's going to get a better team,
mm-hmm.
as everybody says, the grass is always greener down there.
Well, what I saw that boy Roberts
looks good.
In a 15 minute cameo appearance
for £12 million.
Well, that's the thing, if you're a £12 million player, you should be able to come into the SPL right away and hit the ground running.
I know,
and really make an impression. So he's obviously lacked a wee bit of match fitness, mm-hmm. so hopefully as the weeks pass and he gets up to speed.
I think they won the night again, did they? No,
I don't know the night. No,
we're 3-0 up.
Well, that's good to hear.
3-0 up at Murray Park.
Oh, against them?
I think it is. I'll leave find Joe. Mm-hmm. Joe's probably got in touch with me.
But the other thing as well is, it isn't just Roberts. I mean, you've got Scott Allen in there, and you've got Christy banging at the door. But the whole thing is, when Armstrong and to a lesser extent Mackay Stephen are struggling a wee bit,
aye.
You know, the whole idea of having a squad is when somebody's no delivering, it's to put somebody in their place.
Well, that's what I think that the boys should be in the team. Thank you. You'll tell me.
So and goalkeeping wise then, who since you've left, who was the guy that the Celtic goalkeepers? Would it be Boric?
Arthur.
Aye, some man, wasn't he?
Arthur, aye.
Mm. The big game temperament and the mm-hmm. personality.
He daft.
At his best, he was
daft.
He was sensational.
Aye, that's who I would pick, Arthur.
Mm-hmm.
Because I couldn't see anybody else, you know, by Arthur.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
I press the wrong bloody button here. That's that. What was the score? Arthur was good too. Zaluska was good. I liked a young boy. I mean, Martin O'Neill done the dirty with him.
Proto. I liked him.
We'd have won that cup in Seville, that boy in goals.
A lot of guys have said that.
And I spoke to the boy after the game with his mother and father, and he was absolutely devastated. Because I'd met him and I said to him, he played in Seville.
Mm.
He was hoped to play for Seville. It won the league the last 4 games or something they played. I still think he would have won the cup, that big cup for us.
And where does John Fallon in the spectrum of goalkeepers, where does he
say? I just leave that to the fans.
Mm-hmm.
I've got more fans in Glasgow than I have out this way.
Mm-hmm.
It's funny that, you know,
mm-hmm.
a lot of the, you know, the Glasgow boys know that, and different people appreciate me better than the mob out here.
Well,
because the mob out here, there's a lot of them went to Celtic Park, never made it.
All that remains to be said is thanks for your time, John.
No bother.
It's been a great wee chat, and all the best with your book.
Mm-hmm. Well, thank you very much. I'm still getting it done. Part 2 is definitely coming out.
Very good.
sunshine in your smile. Bring me laughter all the while.
St. Anthony said it'd be John Fallon for the podcast, and I thought that'd be great. And I did wonder whether, like many players who played under Steen who weren't part of that core elite, whether there might be a bit of criticism of the manager. And obviously I remember reading some stuff in the press at the time of John's biography coming out, but I didn't quite expect the volume of effing and jeffing. Anyway, before we get on to me saying cheerio, there is the question, talking of John's autobiography. So the question is, what club did John leave Celtic for in 1972? That is, what club did Mr. at Sligo Tim leave the hoops for to go and join in 1972? Answers into harrybradycu@gmail.com. That's harrybradycu@gmail.com. So if you can get your answers in to us by midnight on Monday the 14th of March, that more or less gives you 2 weeks. So that's midnight, Monday the 14th of March. Get your answers in to harrybradycu@gmail.com. That was St. Anthony with John Fallon. This is me, Harry Brady, saying good night and God bless. Good night.
Bring me fun, bring me sunshine, bring me love, sweet love. Bring me fun, bring me sunshine.